Hello, and thank you for watching this lecture. This is on Ovid's Metamorphoses, Books 1 and 2, and this is Professor Ryan Paul from A&M Kingsville. Just to give a brief overview of some stylistic issues related to Metamorphoses, and there'll be more detail on this in the lecture on Ovid. It's a collection of stories from Greek and Roman myth, and Ovid has put them together in one collection, and there's a sort of loose narrative style linking them all together. The stories often bleed from one into the next. They connect from one to the next. There are also embedded stories where within one story he'll start telling about another one that's somehow related. The common theme, as the title of the book tells us, is transformation. And these transformations are linked with the extremes of emotion, the extremes of human passion. And the most particular ones that we have are love or lust, hatred, desire, fear, envy, emotions like that. So think about the way in which Ovid displays the effects metaphorically of the extremes of human passion on individual identity. Book one, The Shaping of Changes, and I should just note that the translation I am using is by Charles Martin, and it was published in 2004 by W.W. Norton. So it begins, of course, with an invocation to the Muses. My mind leads me to speak now of forms changed into new bodies. O gods above, inspire this undertaking, which you've changed as well, and guide my poem in its epic sweep from the world's beginning to the present day. So the gods have inspired him to change from one type of poem that he was planning on writing to write on this poem of transformation. So he asked for them to inspire him to write of these transformations, these metamorphoses. So he begins with the creation. And like Hesiod, we start off with a world of, or a universe of chaos. All that there is chaos. And it's very unstable because all of the matter is mixed together in discord and anarchy. But the seeds of life are there. And so Ovid tells us that some god or kinder nature, doesn't say who, but separates and divides chaos. And it's through this act of separation and division, putting the land in one place, the seas in one place and everything, then that's what allows life to come forth. As this creation continues, humanity emerges. Now man was born, either because the framer of all things, the fabricator of this better world, created man out of his own divine substance, or else because Prometheus took up a clod so lately broken off from lofty ether that it still contained some elements in common with its kin, and mixing it with water, molded it into the shape of gods who govern all. So notice that Ovid isn't as concerned with giving us specific answers the way Hesiod was. He's saying, well, we don't know. Some god created the universe, separated everything, not sure who it was. And some god maybe created humans, or maybe it was Prometheus, not really sure. So he's offering up these different myths for entertainment, for our consideration. And each different option that he presents us is perhaps different idea or different interpretation of what it means to be human. We get the recounting of the four ages. The golden age, of course, was innocent. They were without any form of law, without any form of conflict. They had no labor. Their food just rose from the ground, and they lived in an eternal springtime. Then we have the silver age, in which Jupiter separates spring into four different seasons, and thus humans have to work for their goods. So we have the birth of labor with the Silver Age. And then we have the Bronze Age, more cruel, more violent than those before, but still not corrupt. So similar in many ways to Hesiod's outline, although he doesn't give us a specific heroic age the way Hesiod does. And the final of the four ages is the Modern Age, or the Iron Age. And just as Hesiod, Ovid is disdainful of the morality of the Iron Age, although perhaps Ovid is a little less sincere in his disdain. He writes, "Last was the age of iron. Suddenly all forms of evil burst upon this time of baser metal. Modesty, fidelity, and truth departed. In their absence came fraud, guile, deceit, the use of violence, and shameful lusting after acquisitions." So that is what's characteristic of modernity, of today. We then get a very brief interlude describing the war with the giants, how they wanted to rule Olympus but were destroyed by Jove. But they are also given a sort of renewed life in human form by their mother Earth. And then we get the story of Lycaon's feast, and this is something that has angered Jove. He's furious about what he's seen on Earth. He talks about how he's traveled to Earth in human form. And Lycaon, who is the ruler of Arcadia, mocked everyone for their piety towards Jove. And even though Jove was in human form, he presented himself as a god. And Lycaon, wanting to test him, plans to kill him in his sleep, and even goes so far as to serve him human flesh in order to test whether or not Jove is omniscient. In some versions of the story outside of Ovid, the flesh that Lycaon serves is that of his own son. And so Jove punishes Lycaon by turning him into a wolf, hence the word lycanthrope for werewolf. And this is, again, Jove is insulted and infuriated by the evil that he has seen on Earth through this through the actions of Lycaon. As a result of his anger, Jove plans to destroy humanity for its wickedness. The other gods mostly go along with it, although some of them are thinking to themselves, who would bring incense to their altars? That's their concern, is that they won't be worshipped. But ultimately, Jove floods the earth with the help of his brother Neptune and the rivers, and they destroy everything. And as Ovid describes it, it's almost like a return to the primordial chaos in which all matter was undifferentiated and mixed. There are no longer boundaries between earth and the sea, for everything is sea, and the sea is everywhere without a shore. After the flood, we are left with the last couple, Deucalion and Pyrrha, the only humans left on Mount Parnassus. Described as, there lived no better nor more upright man, no wife more reverential than his own. And seeing them alive, Jove calls back the seas, and they go back to their proper order, and the land reemerges. Deucalion and Pyrrha, they go to the goddess Themis, and they ask her how they can restore humanity. And she tells them, go from my temple now, with your heads covered and your robes unbound. Behind you, toss the bones of your great mother. And at first they don't understand what this means. This seems disrespectful to toss the bones of their mother, but then they realize, she means the bones of their mother Earth, stones that are on the ground. And so Deucalion and Pyrrha pick up the stones and cast them behind them, and the stones are transformed into new humans. As they descend, they veil their heads and loosen up their robes and cast the stones behind them as the goddess bade them to do. And as they did, these stones, you needn't take this part of it on faith, for it's supported by an old tradition, these stones at once begin to lose their hardness and their rigidity. Slowly they soften. Once softened, they begin to take on shapes. So the stones give us a new race of humans. And thus we have the second creation. The earth spontaneously creates new animals to accompany the new humans. And we get a brief bit of a sort of quasi-scientific discussion from Ovid. He says, it is when heat and moisture join as one that life is generated. All living forms originate from these opposing sources. So drawing there on Aristotelian science to explain how it is that the earth could just create these new animals as part of our second creation. And one of the beasts created by the earth was a giant serpent, a giant python, that tormented many people until Apollo killed it. And in remembrance, he institutes the Pythian Games, where the victors are always given an oaken garland. This seems like a sort of a strange little story, but it's really the purpose here is to lead into the next story, because as Ovid's audience would have known, the laurel wreath, the laurel garland, is what's normally given to victors of sporting games, or generals, victorious generals in war, or noted poets, but here we're told that it's a different type of garland because the laurel tree didn't yet exist. And so the next story tells us of how the laurel tree came into creation. The story of the laurel tree is the story of Apollo and Daphne. So Apollo is, of course, an archer, and he sees Cupid, who also carries a bow and arrow, and mocks him. And he says, "What are you doing with such manly arms, lascivious boy? That bow befits our brawn. Content yourself with kindling love affairs with your wee torch, and don't claim our glory." So, of course, Cupid is angry about this and decides that he is going to prove that his bow and arrow are more powerful than Apollo's. So he shoots a gold arrow of love at Apollo and a lead-tipped arrow at Daphne, which makes her flee those who love her. And Phoebus, Apollo, sees Daphne and, of course, falls in love. At first sight, Phoebus loves her and desires to sleep with her. Desire turns to hope. And his own prophecy deceives the god. That is, his mockery of Cupid is now sort of turned back on him, as Cupid's arrow has kindled a love affair that now torments Phoebus Apollo himself. So in the first of what we'll see is a pattern in many stories in the Metamorphoses, Apollo pursues his love and she flees, and he's yelling, "Please stop, wait, I'm a god, I'm not just some animal chasing you, I'm not just some everyday guy," but she refuses to listen, and he becomes more and more aggressive and crazed in his pursuit of Daphne. And she calls out to her father, the river god Peneus. She calls out to him for help. "Help me, dear father. If your waters hold divinity, transform me and destroy that beauty by which I have too well pleased." So it's striking that she wants the beauty to be destroyed. It's the beauty that's to blame for this lust on Apollo's part, she says. And so she is transformed into a tree. Loving her still, the god puts his right hand against the trunk, and even now can feel her heart as it beats under the new bark. He hugs her limbs as if they were still human, and then he puts his lips against the wood, which, even now, is adverse to his kiss. But Apollo is able to find some comfort in his new relationship with Daphne, the laurel tree. "Although you cannot be my bride, you will assuredly be my own tree, O laurel, and will always find yourself girding my locks, my lyre, and my quiver too. You will adorn great Roman generals. You will protect the portals of Augustus. You will be an evergreen forever, bearing your brilliant foliage with glory." So Daphne escapes, but on another hand, doesn't escape. She now becomes the accoutrement of Apollo. She becomes his symbol, that he will break off her branches and leaves and use them as he wishes. So it's not exactly an escape in a certain sense. So this brings us to the story of Jove and Io. Peneus is, of course, miserable that his daughter has been lost to him, and so the other rivers gather to commiserate with him, except for one, Inachus, whose own daughter Io has also disappeared. And so we learn the story of her disappearance. She had been desired by Jupiter, of course, and pursuing her, she had fled. And Jupiter had covered the earth with a dark mist so that he could seize and dishonor her, as it's described in this translation. And so that is what happened to Io at first. Of course, Juno sees this mist on the earth and says, "That looks odd. Jove must be doing something down there. Let me go find out what my husband is up to." And while she's approaching, having intuited his wife's approach, Jove had already metamorphosed Io into a gleaming heifer, a beauty still, even as a cow. Despite herself, Juno gave this illusion her approval, and feigning ignorance, Juno asked him for her as a gift. And of course, Jove can't say, "Well, no, I don't want to give you this cow," so he gives Juno the cow, which is, again, his lover transformed. In her jealousy, Juno takes Io and places her under the guard of Argus, who is a watchman that has 100 eyes. So even when some are asleep, there's always eyes watching whatever he's supposed to be guarding. And poor Io, of course, suffers. She still has her human mind, even though she's in the shape of a cow. She meets up with her family, and she's able to scratch out symbols in the ground indicating who she is. And her father, of course, is miserable about this. "You make no answer, unable to respond. And all that you can manage now, you moo. Now I must pick your husband from my herd, and now must find your offspring there as well." It's sort of tragic, although it's perhaps also a little humorous as well. But poor Io, of course, is suffering, and her family is suffering while she is stuck as a cow. And so Jove eventually feels bad about this, and he sends Mercury to free Io. He says, take care of Argus for me. So Mercury comes, and he disguises himself as a shepherd, and he begins to play music on a reed pipe for Argus. And Argus says, "That's a very interesting instrument you've got there. Where did it come from?" So Mercury tells him the story, which leads us to one of our embedded narratives. Within the story of Jove and Io, we have Mercury telling the story of Pan and Syrinx, and it's fairly similar. Pan had been attracted to the beauty of Syrinx, pursued her. She had been transformed by water nymphs into marsh reeds as she fled from the god. And so Pan made this flute out of his transformed lover so that he could communicate with her. And it's just a very short story inserted in the midst of the Jove and Io story. But it echoes the themes that we've been seeing so far. Lust, desire, women fleeing from the lustful desires of the gods, and transformation. So, back to the Jove and Io story, Argus falls asleep after hearing Mercury tell him about Pan and Syrinx and playing music on the reed flute. So Mercury beheads him. And we're told in just a brief aside that Juno takes his eyes and puts them in the feathers of her bird, that is, the peacock. But Juno is still not done with Io. She torments her, has her chased by a fury across the earth. And finally, Jove begs her, says, "Please end the torment. I won't mess with her anymore. You don't need to worry about me betraying you with Io." So Juno relents, and Io is transformed back into her human form. And in fact, as we learn, becomes a goddess for the Egyptians and gives birth to her son. And the last thing we read about in Book 1 is about a friend of Io's son, Phaethon, who was told by his mother that he was the son of Phoebus Apollo. After being mocked for his claims, he asks his mother to prove his parentage. So she sends him off to the east to find his father's home, to find the home of Phoebus, the sun god. And that's where Phaethon sets off at the end of Book 1. Book 2 of Mortal Children and Immortal Lusts. So we begin with the story of Phaethon and him arriving at his father's palace, which is this great and impressive palace. The artwork is described in much detail. And we see that the various embodiments of time are also there at Phoebus's court. Day, month, year, the various seasons, they are all there. All the things that are governed by the passage of time, or that deal with the passage of time. So Phaethon asks Phoebus if he is truly his father, and Phoebus says, "Yes, I am your father, and I will give you any gift that you want. I swear to give you whatever gift you wish." And this is a theme that we see in this poem numerous times, people making, swearing to give gifts, and then this oath coming back ironically. So Phoebus offers to give Phaeton whatever gift he wants, and Phaeton says, okay, let me drive the chariot of the sun across the sky. And of course, as we find out, Phoebus is not happy about this. He wishes that he had not made this request, or not made this oath, to give his son whatever he wanted. So he can't go back on his oath, but he tries to convince his son to change his request. You seek a gift that is too great for you, beyond your strength, beyond your boyish years. Your fate is mortal. What you ask for isn't. Out of your ignorance, you seek much more than even gods are able to control. For though each god may do just as he pleases, none but myself may set his heel upon the fire-bearing axle. So this is something too mighty for you, because you're only a mortal. In fact, no other god could do what I do. It is my duty alone. So this is Phoebus's attempt to convince his son, which, of course, does not succeed. Phaeton refuses all the other gifts his father offers him. He says, I want to take this, I want to ride the chariot. Phoebus tries to give him some final advice, but when Phaeton sets out the horses, he's too light, he's not as heavy as his father, so the horses, unused to the lighter load, break out and run free, and Phaeton's unable to control them. As he's being dragged around the sky in this chariot, out-of-control chariot, Phaeton realizes that he's made a mistake. Unlucky Phaeton at once turned pale, and suddenly his knees began to shake with terror, and his eyes were darkened by excessive light. And now the god's true son regrets he ever touched his father's horses, is sorry to have found his origins, and sorry that his prayer was ever answered. So this sense of once you achieve your desires, those desires are perhaps not quite as pleasurable as you had hoped they had been. Another theme that comes up throughout this poem. And Phaeton's reckless flight causes great destruction. The cities are collapsed from the fire, forests burn, crops are destroyed, the rivers burn and dry up, the seas recede and hide from the flames. And even Mother Earth herself weeps and begs Jove not to torment her, says, just destroy me if you're instead of torturing me. But if you're not going to stop it, at least look, you're the heavens. Everything is in danger of being destroyed. The heavens, the earth, all of it. So Mother Earth weeps and begs Jove for help. And Jove agrees to help, but in a very oddly political moment, before he does anything. Before he would commit himself, however, the Father Almighty made the other gods, especially the god who gave his son the chariot, swear that the gravest fate hung over all unless he should take action. So he gets them to agree, look, things are going to be really bad if I don't do anything. And he makes sure that Phoebus agrees that Jove has to do something or else all will be destroyed before Jove actually takes action. Perhaps protecting himself, covering his ass, so to speak. So Jove destroys the chariot with his thunderbolt. Phaeton's corpse lands in Italy and is buried and memorialized there by some naiads, forest nymphs. And Phoebus mourns for a whole day. The sun is hidden. And his mother, Clymene, the mother of Phaeton, that is, goes mad with grief and seeks out her son's burial spot. So thus we get the end of Phaeton's reckless flight across the heavens. Phaeton's death, though, leads us into another series of stories. First, we get the brief story of the Heliads, who are his sisters, Clymene's other daughters, and they also mourn for Phaeton around the river Po, where he fell. And after 4 months of grieving, they are transformed into trees. And their blossoms, we're told, are what will be worn by Roman brides. So we have a little story, one brief story that emerges out of Phaeton's death. And we get a second story, this one of Cycnus, who's the young king of Liguria, and who as a friend or lover of Phaeton, had a great deal of passion for Phaeton, and he wanders the riverside in mourning over his lost love, and eventually he has transformed himself into a bird, into a swan, out of his grief for his lost friend. And we get the brief story of Phoebus's anger. He no longer wishes to drive the chariot of the sun, and says, why does it someone else do it? And he's at first angry at Jove for killing his son, and then he's angry at the horses, who he blames for the death of his son. But he finally agrees to take up the job again after the other gods entreat him and ask him. And Jove says, look, I defends himself over killing the sun, said I had to do it, but you have to do this. You're the god of the sun, and I'm the king of the gods, so do what I say. So Phoebus is eventually coerced into taking the job up again. And now we get a longer story emerging from Phaeton's death. In the aftermath, Jove goes around and inspects the heavens for damage from the fire, and then goes about and inspects the earth for damage. And while in Arcadia, he sees the nymph Callisto, who is a virgin and follower of Diana, and of course Jove is taken by lust for her. And he appears to Callisto in the guise of Diana herself. And when Diana approaches Callisto, the virgin sprang up from her grassy couch. Hail, goddess, far superior to Jove, a judgment I would stand by in his presence. He laughed to be preferred above himself, and joined their lips together with a kiss, much less than modest, more than maidenly. As she began recounting the day's hunt, he interrupted her with an embrace that clearly showed his criminal intent. So in disguise as Diana, Jove accosts Callisto. She fights back, but Jove overpowers her resistance, and then leaves her after having his way with her. Callisto, at first seeing Diana, is very fearful, thinking that it's perhaps Jove in disguise, but ultimately recognizing the real Diana, falls back in with her followers, but her behavior reveals her sense of shame, even though Diana doesn't notice it. But Callisto feels ashamed that she is no longer a virgin. Her shame is described as such. She does not lift her gaze up from the ground, nor walk beside the goddess as she used to, nor take the lead. And she is silent now. That and her blushing show her loss of honor. The countless indications of her guilt went by Diana, much too innocent to recognize loss of virginity. They say her nymphs were well aware of it. So Diana may not know, but the other nymphs recognize it. We can imagine poor Callisto being mocked by the nymphs, who know that Callisto is no longer pure or virginal as they are. And finally, it's not until Callisto's pregnancy becomes visible that Diana realizes what has happened and casts her out, does not allow her to be with her anymore. And Callisto ultimately gives birth to a son named Arcas. Juno, however, is still upset, still angry about Callisto, blames Callisto, of course, for everything, and transforms her into a bear in order to rob her of her beauty. And so poor Callisto is then cast out, lives a life out in the woods as a bear, frightened both of hunters and of animals, other bears, wolves, basically tormented, living a human mind in a bear's body. We get a poignant expression of her grief and the bitterness over it. Within the bear, there was a human mind, however. Constant groans expressed her grief as she reared up and raised her hands to heaven, her gesture showing what she could not say, the pain of Jovian ingratitude. So while it's Juno that transforms her, the narrator does give us a sense that, you know, Jove is at least partially to blame because he had his way with this woman and then did nothing to help her. So she suffers from Jovian ingratitude. He gives her no thanks, even though he took his pleasure from her, and has caused her all this suffering. And in the conclusion to this story, we learn that Arcas grows up and becomes a hunter. Once, as a young man, he's out hunting. He nearly kills his mother, but Jove stops his spear and places them both in the heavens as constellations. And we have a brief little moment where we see that Juno goes to complain about Jove making them constellations, and that if Jove should ever divorce her and marry Callisto, that Oceanus and Tethys will stand beside her and they will not honor Jove's new wife. Just a very brief moment, brief story that's sort of tail end tacked on to the story of Jove, Callisto, and Arcas. And then we get a somewhat odd transition as Ovid tells us, well, this was around the time when the raven turned from white to black. We get this sideways shift into another narrative about birds. And we learn how Apollo's white raven saw Coronis, which was a woman beloved of Apollo, having sex with someone, and decides to go off to tell Apollo. But he meets with the crow, who says, don't tell Apollo this news. You may think you're serving your master and they're going to get a reward, but in fact, you're going to be punished. And we get another embedded narrative as the crow tells her story to the raven. Once she was a virgin princess and had been transformed into a crow because of the lust of Neptune. And she was given to Minerva and made Minerva's companion, but when she gave Minerva some bad news, which will come up in a story later on in this book, she was then punished by Minerva and no longer allowed to be Minerva's companion. So she says to the raven, don't give your master bad news, they're not going to like it, they'll just end up hurting the messenger. The raven, of course, doesn't listen, tells Phoebus what had happened. Phoebus, in his anger, kills Coronis for her infidelity, but then is angry at himself for what he did, and angry at the raven for giving him the news, so he turns the raven black and takes Coronis' unborn child and gives it to the centaur Chiron to raise. And then we have a brief interlude about Chiron's daughter, Ochiro, who is a fully human daughter, even though Chiron is a centaur. And Ochiro prophesizes about the child's future, that he'll become a great healer, will at one point be punished and killed by Jove, but eventually made a god himself. And then Ochiro herself is transformed into a horse as she's telling these fortunes. And she says, as she's telling her fortunes and being transformed, the fate that changes me prohibits speech and makes my own voice inaccessible. Those arts by which I have earned heaven's wrath are scarcely worth the price I pay for them. I'd rather not know what the future holds. So again, that idea that the gifts of the gods are often double-edged, that to know the future is in some ways a curse just as much as a power or gift. And so again, she is transformed into a horse. And then we get another strange narrative shift. Chiron asks Phoebus for help with his daughter, but Phoebus is off in disguise somewhere as a shepherd. And so this leads us into an unconnected tale. Well, what was going on while Phoebus was off in disguise? Mercury saw his cattle and decided to steal them. And there's one witness, another shepherd named Battus, and he says, look, I'll give you this heifer, but you can't tell anyone what you saw. And Battus says, of course, I won't tell anyone. And then Mercury comes back, and in a little bit of entrapment, comes back in another disguise and says back to Battus, hey, if you tell me, if you've seen a herd of cattle nearby, I'll give you two cattle. And Battus says, okay, I'll take those and I'll tell you where the herd is. So Mercury then says, well, you've betrayed me. I told you to not tell, and you've told. So I'm going to punish you by turning you into stone. And he's turned into a stone called the Tattletale. And this leads into a longer story involving Mercury, about Mercury and Aglauros. And Aglauros, we might remember, or we should remember, as a character mentioned in the Crow's story. It was Aglauros who had betrayed Minerva, and that's what the Crow had told Minerva about. So Mercury is flying along after his transformation of the shepherd into a rock, and he observes a festival for Minerva. And he sees a beautiful woman named Herse, and he falls in love with her. And then he goes and has this encounter with Aglauros, which is rather strange. It appears that Aglauros insults him in some way. And remember, Aglauros is the woman from the Crow's story. So she's done something wrong here, pissed off Mercury and apparently pissed off Minerva. So Minerva, realizing who Aglauros was, realizing that this is the woman who not only insulted Mercury, but also did something to betray her in the Crow's story, decides to go down to the House of Envy. And she meets the figure of Envy there and asks her to infect Aglauros, to make Aglauros suffer from envy. And we're given this great, graphic, disgusting allegorical description of envy that many later writers would pick up on. Edmund Spenser, John Milton, many of the Renaissance authors pick up on images like this in their allegorical figures. Her glance is sidewise and her teeth are black. Her nipples drip with poisonous green bile and venom from her dinner coats her tongue. She only smiles at sight of another's grief, nor does she know, disturbed by wakeful cares, the benefits of slumber. When she beholds another's joy, she falls into decay and rips down only to be ripped apart, herself the punishment for being her. So it's a brilliant description of what it's like to be envious, what the state of envy does to one's mind, the way it is punishment itself, even when you are tearing down someone else. So envy breeds her poison in the girl, and spreads her venom right into her bones, so that she would have a cause for grief, draws her picture of her sister's fortune, her blessed marriage to the handsome god. Aglauros, maddened, feasts on her own heart in secret wretchedness as anxious day succeeds each anxious night. So Aglauros is tormented, destroying herself in jealousy and envy over her sister's fortunate wedding to Mercury. And so in the final stage of the story, Aglauros, angry over her sister's wedding to Mercury, eventually tries to block Mercury's entrance to their home, says, "I will not leave until I've frustrated your attempts." And Mercury says, "Fine," and transforms her into a stone. And thus the end of the story of Aglauros and Mercury's second transformation of a human into stone, perhaps because Mercury is quick is speed, stones are slow. It's a ironic transformation given his powers. Perhaps one way to read it. And finally, the last story of book two, Jove and Europa. Mercury comes home and Jove says, "You will go and you will find this herd of cattle. I want you to tend to it. I want you to drive them down to the sea." Mercury says, "Okay." Of course, what's going on is that Jove is disguised as a bull in this herd of cattle so that he can approach Europa, the beautiful daughter of King Agenor. And he is very gentle when he approaches her. She touches him, pets him, and she even becomes so enamored of this gentle bull that she climbs upon its back. And this is when Jove takes the opportunity to run out to sea, kidnapping his newest love. Here's a little bit of an amusing description from the story of Jove and Europa. "Majestic power and erotic love do not get on together very well, nor do they linger long in the same place." So that's why Jove has to transform himself into the lowly bull. And then in his disguise, as he is courting Europa, the lover, quite beside himself, rejoices and, as a preview of delights to come, kisses her fingers, getting so excited that he can scarcely keep from doing it. So we see Jove just enraptured and nearly out of control in his lust for Europa. And of course, all the while in disguise as a bull. Some questions to consider for books one and two, and of course for the poem as a whole. How does Ovid's portrayal of the gods compare to Hesiod's or Homer's? How is he different? Would you say that his gods are more or less moral or ethical in their behavior? Are they more or less human, that is, similar to humans in their behaviors and thought processes? Or are they more mystical, more divine? And how are the relationships between humans and the gods? Are they quite as troubled, as painful? Are they more strange? So what is Ovid doing with the gods? What is his philosophy of the gods compared to Hesiod's and Homer's? Also, you notice that Ovid covers some of the same stories that they do. And this will, as we get on further into the book, you'll see him covering some elements of the Iliad and the Odyssey as well. But in this, we see his story of the creation. How is his description of this story, how is his approach to the story different from Hesiod's? Are his concerns the same thing? Remember that Hesiod was didactic in his focus and wanting to create order and promote order. What is Ovid doing differently in his telling of this story? Further questions. How does Ovid unify the very diverse stories that he brings together? How does he create narrative continuity from one story to the next? And how effective is it from going from one narrative to the others? How are they linked to each other? And is there an importance, a significance to those linkages that he makes? How does he create humor in his stories of gods and humans, if you think they are humorous? How does he attempt to make us laugh? And what are the causes of the metamorphoses we see? What are the common elements between them? And think both about the literal causes and the metaphorical or figurative causes. And again, how this works to how these different changes and metamorphoses from story to story and within the stories serve in some paradoxical way a larger sense of unity of narrative continuity, creating a whole out of all of these very different parts. So the next step, read and review books 1 through 5 of the Metamorphoses if you have not done so. There'll be 2 more videos for this section, video covering books 3 and 4, and then a video covering books 5 and 6. Those will be up in the first half of this week. And the quiz is on Metamorphoses books 1 through 5, and that is due Wednesday at midnight. If you have questions, of course, you can contact me, phone, text, email, Blackboard. Otherwise, have a happy August and good luck with your final weeks of the course.